Good morning and welcome to Scottsdale Christian Church. Please stand and worship our Lord with us.
And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. I'm moving forward to follow after you. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do.
Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. In every season, grace has been enough, and I'm believing the best is yet to come. The cross before me, my hope on things above, and in you, Jesus, the best is yet to come.
Like never before.
Father, thank you so much for this beautiful morning. Thank you for this time together, for this place to come and worship you, and that we have the freedom to do so, God. And certainly, your presence is an open door, not just to our eternity, but to our adventure and our life, God. Through all the ups and the downs, when we invite you to be the Lord of our life, when we believe what you say about us, that we are chosen, that we are loved, that you ordained us before we were even born, God, and that you have a plan for each and every one of us, and all we have to do is invite you in and follow you through that door. And Holy Spirit, I pray we take that so personal. We take that to heart, that we are who you say we are, God, that we are loved, that we are forgiven, that you have mercy for us, that you have a plan for us, God, that you have ways for us to touch this world, and not just as individuals, but as a church family. And I pray, Holy Spirit, you just breathe life into the message today that Tom's about to deliver. Breathe life into this worship. Breathe life into how we invite you in, how we embrace you, God, and how we love you, and how we take ownership of the love you have for us. And that is only through our Savior, Jesus Christ, and what he did on the cross for each and every one of us. So right now, in this worship and at this time, we're going to thank our Heavenly Father, and we are going to thank our Savior, Jesus Christ. He is so worthy. We love you so much. We thank you in his name. Amen.
Thank you. of your name,
Jesus.
Jesus, your name is power.
Shout out for our Lord Jesus, say hallelujah. Please be seated.
Buckle up and hold on. At our church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe in God's radical, unconditional, and unwavering love for us. At our church, we believe that Jesus is God. We also affirm that you may or may not believe that Jesus is God. And we're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus. For years, churches have placed a high priority on Jesus as the get-out-of-hell-free card. At our church, we place the highest priority on Jesus as a live-life-to-the-fullest invitation. At our church, we believe every person has a dream deep inside their hearts, and that God put that dream there, not for our glory, but for His. At our church, we're not concerned with where you've been, but where you're going. At our church, we believe that the Bible is God's Word. It is real. It is living. It is active. We believe that people who don't go to church anywhere are not the enemy. They are real people who need the perfect love that only God can give. And we believe that God gives this love through, of all people, us. At our church, we do not and we will not display a holier-than-thou attitude toward anyone. We are all broken people, but He is putting us back together. And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that He really died on a cross, and that He really rose again on the third day. And we cannot and we will not candy coat or water down that message, ever. Today, you've chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially dangerous message. Welcome to our church.
Good morning. I need you to all give yourselves a big hand. You made it here this morning on Marathon Sunday. I know it took a little extra planning for some of you, but we appreciate it. We're glad you're here. So today I'm going to ask you a very important question that I want you to think about. Are you doing what Jesus asked of you? He asked you to be here this morning, and you're here, so you're starting off on the right foot. But are you doing everything that Jesus is asking of you? I know that's not a very hard question. I know it's easy to do it, right? The question and your response to that as we go through this morning could be life-changing. Are we doing what Jesus asked of us? This morning, I want us to look at that question. I want us to look at an interaction that Jesus had with Simon Peter. The Apostle Peter. I want us to see how Jesus' interaction with him in his life and how that interaction changed his outcome, sent Peter in a certain direction that would contemplate his entire life. The possible outcome for Peter and this one little interaction that they had has such a huge meaning for us as much as it did for Peter. So this morning we're going to look at Luke 5. It's on page 718 in your chair Bibles. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 11. This is early in Jesus' ministry. He's beginning to go around and preach and talk to people. He hasn't got all of his disciples gathered up at this point. His ministry is still fairly young. Starting with verse 1. One day as Jesus was standing by the lake, the people were crowding around him and listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down the nets to catch." Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. Because you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had just taken. And so were James and John and the sons of Zebedee and Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boats up on the shore, left everything, and followed him. There's a lot in that little interaction between Jesus and Peter. So I want us to break it down a little bit. There's three things that Jesus asked of Simon Peter in this interaction. The first thing we see Jesus asked him is, "Hey, can I borrow your boat?" He got into one of the boats that belonged to Simon, asked him to put out a little to shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. Just a simple request. "Hey, can I use your boat? Can you push it out a little bit?" We can look at this from a couple of different angles. Jesus, for one, was trying to get in a better position so the people that were there could hear him. He was trying to get in a more stage-type position so that he could be seen and he could be heard by more of the crowd. For Jesus, it didn't probably really matter whose boat he used. There were other boats there. But he chose Simon Peter's. He chose Peter's boat. Jesus had his own reasonings for choosing Peter's boat. And we'll see some of those in a few minutes as we read through the scripture. But what effect did Jesus choosing Peter's boat have on Peter? What was the results that Peter experienced because Jesus chose his boat? The big obvious one is Peter had the best seat in the house for Jesus' message. You think that was a coincidence? Jesus didn't have a microphone. If Peter had been up on the shore, he might not have been able to hear Jesus' message that morning. He may have been in the back of the crowd or some tall person standing in front of him. But by Jesus using his boat and asking him to pull it out, Jesus was sitting there only a few feet away from Jesus when he gave the message. He sat right next to Jesus as Jesus was teaching. He had the perfect spot to hear everything that Jesus had to say that morning. But Jesus asking Peter to use his boat and to put it out a little while, a little further from the shore, Peter was a captive audience. I mean, here is Jesus. He's talking. I can't sleep sitting here beside of him. He might kick me or elbow me. Wouldn't you hate to be elbowed by Jesus for sleeping near his sermon? So Peter had the perfect vantage point. And don't you know that Jesus had that message planned for Peter? What has Jesus asked of you? You will notice at the bottom of your bulletin there, there's some blanks. Some blank spaces. So you can answer this question for yourself. Now, you don't have to do it this morning. You could do it this afternoon at 1 o'clock. Don't wait past that, though. You can do this later. But I want you this morning to start thinking about that. Letting that question run through your head. What has Jesus asked me to do? What direction is God asking me to go in? I want you to think back to a time when you were in the right place at the right time for something exciting to happen. Maybe it was a time when you were standing across the room and there's this person comes in, your sweetie, and you hadn't met eyes for the first time. And now you're still with them. Or maybe it's when you were that 1,000th customer at the grocery store and you won that big 20-pound ham. Okay, a turkey? I'm from the South. We win hams. But I don't think that's what Jesus is talking about. I think since we're in church and we're using the Bible, it's probably a little bit more of a churchy answer than that. Think back to that first time you heard about Jesus. That first time that you understood who Jesus was, at least at some level. Where were you? Why were you there at that moment? Maybe someone asked you to go to church with them that day. Or maybe they asked you to attend a Bible study. Or maybe you got up that morning and thought, I need to go to church today. Let me get on Google and find a church close to me. Or maybe it was just a conversation that developed between you and somebody else. Just at the right place at the right time, you heard about Jesus. Maybe Jesus was organizing the circumstances of that meeting and that situation all along. Maybe he wanted you to have the best seat in the house for the message he needed you to hear at that moment. I've had several of these moments in my life. I can remember one about 14 years ago. It was on a Saturday night. And I had this overwhelming feeling that I needed to go to this certain church for that Saturday night service. I went, and I can still remember how emotional I was during that service. How that service touched me. See, it touches me still. I remember thinking I was right where I needed to be at that moment. Right where God needed me to be at that moment. After the service, I talked with the pastor and a couple other people. And that night would change the trajectory of my life. That night was a turning point for me in so many ways. I often wonder, what if I hadn't attended that service that night. At that time. At that time in my life, I was struggling with a lot of different things. Life was just so overwhelming. And I was tired. I'm so glad I said yes to Jesus when he said, "Will you go attend this church service tonight? I think you'll get something out of it. They got a message I need you to hear, and I need you to hear it tonight." What about you? What's your story? Let's go back to Peter's encounter with Jesus. What if when Jesus asked to use Peter's boat, Peter said no? What if Peter said, "Jesus, I've been up all night long, and we've caught absolutely nothing. I'm tired. I smell bad. They smell bad. And I just want to go home, eat something, take a shower, and go to bed. Because tonight, I've got to come back and do this all over again. And because I didn't catch anything last night, tonight's going to be even more important. Because I got to feed my family. This is my job. Use someone else's boat. I'm going home." What would Peter have missed out on? How many times have you said no to Jesus when he needed you to be somewhere? To hear something, to do something, to help someone. Or maybe he needs you to be in a spot where you can receive something. Receive some help. Something that you need. How many times have you said no to Jesus? And what did you miss out on because of you said no? It's kind of a deep question, isn't it? Kind of makes your mind wonder back and forth. Maybe even a little guilt there. Let's go back to Jesus' encounter with Peter and see what that second thing he asked of Peter. The second thing he asked is, he asked him to go back out and fish. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down the nets for a catch." Now, why in the world would Jesus ask him to do this? Peter had just been fishing all night. Didn't catch anything. Well, if we look at it from Jesus' aspect, what was the results that happened because he said yes to this question? Peter got a boatload of fish in a matter of seconds. He didn't even have to work for it. Now, I love this part of the story because this is the feel-good part of the story. First, you know what Peter was thinking when Jesus asked him to go back out and put those nets back out. This is a waste of time. I'm the fisherman. I know that the waters and the catch don't change that quick because it's all based on, you know, the tides and the sun and the wind and the tadpoles and all the other things. And they don't change that fast. So Peter knew that this was a waste of time, or at least had a really high expectation of it being a waste of time. But because of what Peter had just heard and what he already knew about Jesus, he said, "Okay, I'll do it anyway, even though I'm going to have to wash these nets again." But what point was Jesus trying to make to Peter when he asked him to go back out? I think there's more than one possibility or more than one thing that Jesus was trying to show Peter when he asked him to go back out and fish. One, I think Jesus wanted to reward Peter, to bless him for doing what he had asked him to do. Jesus knew that Peter and the other fishermen depended on a good catch to feed their families, to provide for their families. So taking him out for a big catch was Jesus' way of taking care of Peter, providing for him, taking care of his needs. I think another reason that Jesus wanted him to go back out, because it had been such a bad fishing day. Jesus was able to show his power when he went back out with Peter, to show his power over nature, to show that he was who he was claiming to be, and to set things up for what was to come for Peter. He needed Peter to see who he was firsthand, to experience the blessings that he could bring him firsthand. What has Jesus asked of you? Jesus wants to do the same thing for us. He will ask things of us over and over again. When we follow through, he'll also bless us. Deuteronomy 28 gives us a good outline of what blessings from God looks like. We're not going to read the whole thing, but I want to read a little bit at the very beginning. If you fully obey the Lord, your God, and carefully follow all his commands I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations on earth. All these blessings will come upon you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. Now, I challenge you to go back this week to write that down, Deuteronomy 28, and to go back and to read that whole chapter. Because right after that, it details all the different things that if you obey God, what those blessings will look like. But don't stop there. That second part of that chapter tells you what happens if you disobey God. If you tell God no, what you miss out on and how it affects your life. It also goes to give us an outline of what God wants for us. He wants that first part for us. He wants to bless us. I want you to think about those times when you've been blessed by God. Think about the circumstances that surround those times. When you think about, okay, God did this for me, or I got blessings at this point, what was the circumstances that were surrounding those blessings? Look at how God played a part in those things. Look at what you did right before you got the blessing. Think about what God has done for you in the past. I think we miss out on a lot of what God wants for us because we just don't do what he asked of us. I think one of the areas this really shows is in our finances. No, this is not going to be a tithing sermon. But I remember how hard it was for me to start tithing. And I remember when I finally gave in and did it, how the blessings did come. Now, I didn't win the lottery. I didn't get this big inheritance of money from somewhere. But good things did start to happen. I got a little raise, which kind of covered my tithing. Had a couple of bills that got reduced a little bit. I realized I didn't need cable anymore. Just little things started to happen around that. Even though I was giving more to God, I was still making it. And somehow, when I needed something, I either realized I didn't need it, or somehow God provided it for me. I saw the blessings. I experienced the blessings. If you're struggling with your finances and nothing ever seems to work in your favor, and you wonder, when is my blessings going to come? I hear all these people having all this good luck, and they always have their best job, and they always get a raise. They never struggle. When am I going to get my blessings? Ask yourself, are you doing what God is asking you to do in that area? And that goes for all areas of our life, not just our finances. I think that's when we look for blessings in. That's how we sometimes measure blessings, is by a financial gain. But it's all areas of our life. And we don't even have to understand why it works that way. Peter didn't have to understand. He just knew he got a bunch of fish. And that Jesus was the reason. He didn't have to know the mechanics of how Jesus' mind interacted with the fish mind and made them jump into the net. Peter just knew that Jesus did it, and that this blessing came from him. Look at what Peter said when Jesus asked him to take the boat back out. Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will go let the nets down. Master, because you say so. Do you really think Peter thought they were going to catch anything? Did he start rubbing his hands together and start dreaming about how he's going to spend all the money from all the fish he was going to sell? Just because Jesus said, let's go out and fish. And he pulls out his list and starts making his shopping list of all the things he's going to buy. No, he didn't do it, because he really didn't think it was going to happen. He didn't see any benefit of going back out on the lake and dropping out his nets, but he did it anyway. He obeyed, and he was blessed for it. He said yes, and Jesus rewarded him. What blessings are you missing out on because you are not obeying God? Doing what Jesus asked of you. You don't have to understand it. We just have to do it. Let's see what that third thing that Peter is asked to do. He asked him to follow him. Then Jesus said to Simon, don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people. I always want to say fisher of men, because that's the way we all memorized it years ago, right? You'll be a fisher of men. So they pulled their boats up on the shore, left everything, and followed him. Here we see Peter saying yes to Jesus again. What are the results of him, of this yes? He becomes a disciple. He becomes the Apostle Peter. He will be called the rock, the foundation on which the church will be built. And he gets to spend eternity in heaven. That's some pretty powerful results for just a little three-letter word, yes. As you go through the New Testament, we see how Peter's life is affected from this yes. We see all the things that happened to Peter and all the things that he does that we still use Peter as an example and as a teaching today. Peter became more than just a fisherman. He became that fisherman of men. He has some amazing stories. And he's not perfect. He denies Jesus. He goes against Jesus' wishes and cuts the ear off of the soldier that's trying to arrest Jesus. But Jesus loves him. And every time he messes up, he realizes it, and he says yes to the next question for the next situation. And he moves forward, and he learns from it. What has Jesus asked of you? Jesus will or has asked each and everyone in this room to follow him. Personally, he has asked you that question. Will you follow me? That question, you'll feel it in your heart, in your head, in your surroundings. And each of us will have to answer that question. Will we answer yes? Will we answer no? Will we answer not yet? Maybe tomorrow? Ask me again next month. Will the answer be the same? There are so many benefits to answering yes to this question. Will you follow me? And doing it as soon as possible makes those benefits start so much sooner than if you say no. Life with Jesus is so much better and so much easier than life without him. So have you said yes to following Jesus? If not, let's talk today before you leave. Talk to me. I'll be out in the lobby. I'd love to have a one-on-one conversation with you, me or one of the other elders, or even somebody that's sitting beside of you that you already know. Don't leave without some basis for being able to answer that question. Will you follow me? And if you've already said yes, well, guess what? It doesn't stop there. He will continue to ask you to do things. Each and every one of us is called to do something for him. To do many things for him. Once we finish one task, we're going to get another. And every time we make a conscious effort to say yes or no, or maybe next week. Sometimes it's just to share a message with somebody. Maybe it's just to serve someone. To give more, to sacrifice something so that I can do this for God. With great reward comes great responsibility. We as believers have the greatest reward imaginable. It's beyond our wildest dreams. We cannot sit here this morning if we all got together and tried to figure out what is heaven going to be like. And we came up with our best scenario. We would be way off key. It's so much better than that. It's better than our wildest dreams, better than what we could ever possibly imagine or dream of. With great reward comes great responsibility. But we are also called to be more right here. We're called to share more, to serve more, to be who Jesus wants us to be his hands and feet. Take care of the people that he puts in our path every single day. Are you saying yes to all the things that Jesus is asking you to do? God, Jesus, they speak to us in so many different ways. Maybe he's speaking to you right now through me. Or maybe the person sitting next to you is who he's going to speak through. Or maybe it's going to be that person that you go out to lunch with today. Or maybe he's asking you to be the vessel. Maybe he's asking you to do something today. Maybe you're supposed to ask someone to go to lunch with you after church today. Maybe you're supposed to make somebody a meal and take it to them this week. Or maybe you're supposed to visit someone. Or maybe you're just supposed to pick up the phone and call someone instead of texting or saying hi to them on Facebook? Maybe we're supposed to just knock on that friend's door and say, hey, here to spend some time with you. Maybe he needs you to serve somewhere. Be like Peter. When Jesus asks, say yes. Even when Peter thought it was a waste of time, he still said yes. So even when you can't see the reason why you're saying yes, say yes. Be like Peter. When Jesus asks you to follow him, say yes. I want you to spend some time this week in your Bibles, in prayer. Ask God to show up in your lives this week. Listen for the things he's going to ask you to do this week. And when he asks, say yes and do it. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you so much for being a God that has communication with us. You asked us to do things. You let us have this conversation with you. And we get to respond because you're a real living God. Not these fakes that the world has around us. There's things you want us to do. Give us this morning, everyone in this room, the courage to say yes when you ask us to do whatever it is. Especially when that voice says, will you follow me? Let everyone in this room that's hearing my voice this morning say yes. God, we know that sometimes we don't understand why you're asking me to do this. But we know that you'll always provide for us and always give us the resources we need to do what it is you're asking us to do. This morning, let us be bold. Let us be bold in our yeses. Let us be bold in going out and being your hands and feet. Let us be bold and go out in this community in South Scottsdale and share you with the world, with each other. Give us wisdom to understand your ways. But most of all, let us feel your love. Let us feel how important that is to our lives and how important it is for us to share that with others. Let us be your hands and feet. Let us be a church, a people that says yes every time Jesus asked. And it's in his precious name we pray. Amen.
As we prepare for communion, please stand and sing with us.
I am the wind, and thou art. Your unfailing love, O Lord, is as vast as the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches beyond the clouds.
I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago.
I will meditate on all of your works and consider all your mighty deeds.
And he took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you."
I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will meditate on all your works and consider all your mighty deeds.
All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him.
May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Let your unfailing love surround us, Lord, for our hope is in you alone.
Well, this is the time of our service when we take communion. This is one of those things that Jesus asked us to do. He asked us to do this in remembrance of him, for the sacrifice he made on the cross for us. He paid the price for our sin so that we could one day stand before God and go to heaven. He asked us to do this morning. In a moment, the servers are going to pass the trays with the bread that represents his body and the juice that represents his blood that he gave willingly so that we could be reunited with him and the Father in heaven. We do this because he asked us to do it in remembrance of him. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for having a plan to take care of our sin when you knew that we could not do it on our own. We thank you for sending your son to pay the price. We thank you, Jesus, for taking up the cross that we could not bear, for paying for the sins that we could not do on our own. And all you ask for us in return is to follow you and to remember you. I ask that you bless this time and this simple meal, and that may each one of us in our hearts and our minds at this time remember Jesus, remember what he did for us on the cross, and remember what it means for our future when we say yes. It's in your precious son's name we pray. Amen. Well, since you made it on Marathon Sunday, we want it in the official records. So on the left-hand side of the row, there's a little black book. If you'll just take that and fill it out, we would love to know that you were here with us this morning. If you're new with us, we are so proud that you chose to meet with us today and worship with us today. Also in the back of the chairs, there is a prayer card. If you'll just fill that out, if there's something that you want us to pray with you this week, just fill that card out and we'll be honored to lift you up in prayer in your situation. Or if there's something you want us to praise God for, add that too. We like to see the praises just as much as we like to pray for people. Also, at this time, we'd like to take up an offering, and I'd like to pray for that offering. Father God, we thank you for being the great provider. We thank you for providing for us as individuals and as a church. We thank you for this opportunity to give back. We thank you for making it possible for us to be able to do that. And even though we don't understand why and how things work, we know that when we follow you in all areas of our life, that you bless us. And we don't have to understand anything more than that's God. And that's how he works. We ask that you bless it and give the leaders here the wisdom and the knowledge of how you want this offering to be used to build your kingdom and to spread your name throughout our community. And it's in your precious son's name we pray. Amen. Got a few things. We don't have a lot of announcements. This is kind of that slow time of the year because it's, you know, winter and it's cold. And I love posting the Facebook pictures this week for all the people back east. I mean, I like them to see what kind of weather we're having, you know? If you're not in a Bible study, now's a great time to get in one. On the back of your bulletin, there's a list of all our Bible studies. We've got two that start right after this Sunday service. Phil teaches one right over here. Ray and Linda teach one in the elementary room. Great opportunity. You're already here. You might as well stay, have a Bible study. We have one on Tuesday night at Helen's house. We also have one here on Wednesday night. And there's a ladies group that meets on Tuesday morning. Did I leave any out? I think that's all. Find a Bible study. If it's not one that you like, start one. We'll be glad to do that. We're looking at a couple of new ones that we'd like to get started. So if there's something that just doesn't fit, talk to me. Also, I want to recap yesterday. We had our service Saturday yesterday where we went down to the senior apartment complex down the street from us, and we did our first little outreach there. It's the place where we carried the bags, the Christmas bags. We had about 14 people that showed up from our church to help serve. We had 10 apartments or 10 people that we served. We did. It was really interesting. They were very, didn't know what we would do. What do you need done? Well, I don't know. Yeah, you could flip my mattress. You had to really encourage them to let you do something. And then once you say it, then, oh, well, you know, I haven't been able to dust that fan. And it just kind of, but they were so appreciative. That was the thing that I was just overwhelmed with, was how appreciative they was that somebody cared enough to knock on their door and say, what can you not do that we can do for you? We carried water to all of them because most of them can't carry a case of water. That was something simple that just happened at the last moment. And they was like, oh my gosh, I don't have to carry that from the car and up the steps or not have it at all. So it was just a really great day. I appreciate all that went. And next time I expect a lot more of you to do it. And we will be doing more of them. We're hoping to be able to start a Bible study there soon also. So keep a lookout for our next service Saturday. Also want to recap last week. You know, we had last Sunday morning, Tom Rainer's website and his ministry posted that we were the church they were praying for this week. It has been overwhelmingly a huge success. I have gotten emails and stuff from all over the world of pastors and churches that are praying for us this morning. And who knows? I think there's a couple of little things that's going to happen from that we may be able to see a little headway of some things that might happen this week. So we'll just see. I'm not going to give anything away because I don't know anything yet. But I have faith that God's beginning to work, and it's just amazing that it all happens because our name was being prayed up by pastors and churches all over the world. Such a blessing. We need to return the favor and be praying for other churches and other, not only in our community, but around the world. And you don't have to know them by name, But when you're saying your prayers, pray for all of God's believers around the world. If you don't know who Jesus is, do not leave here this morning without talking to me or talking to someone. If Jesus is asking you this morning, will you follow me? Say yes. If you don't understand what that means, let me help you understand what that means. But don't say no. You could talk to me or one of the elders or whoever you could come with, or go out to lunch with someone. Do it privately, one-on-one. But this is important for us to always listen to what Jesus is asking us to do and to say yes. Y'all have a great week, and we'll see you back next week.
All right. Thanks, Tom. Please stand as we close.
Grace.